The first music you hear is from Phish, an improvisational rock band colloquially known as a jam band, which synthesizes many American genres into one funky, psychedelic jazz blues sound. This is the opening music because as we consider my personal music journey, this is the only logical starting point. My mother found out she was 6.5 months pregnant with me after spending the summer following Phish on tour with a group of friends, participating in an organization called Funky Bitches, which provided menstruation and sexual assault resources to primarily women on the tour, which typically has a massive nomadic following from show to show. The happiest of my family memories take place either in a Phish show or on Shakedown Street, the familiar term for the pop-up lot where the fans set up their food and wares shops in the hours leading up to the show, hoping to make enough money to buy tickets for the next one. This was always where I was allowed and encouraged by both parents to dress the most expressively and dance without fear of sexualization and reprimanding, and scream and clap and sing loudly, even barefoot, where nothing matters more than how sweet the music is making everyone feel. This generous, colorful, music-centered community was my favorite place to be, so much so that in elementary school, when asked what made me happiest in the whole world, I was a little surprised and guilty, but very certain in my answer. Live music. The first song I ever remember hearing and loving was My Girl by The Temptations. My kindergarten summer camp used it in their annual lip sync event, and it was just as adorable as you're imagining. But in the process of practicing all the dances, we listened to that song over and over again for weeks, and none of us ever got tired of it. They even had to remind us not to really sing during the lip sync. My Girl was the group's first number one hit and continues to be The Temptations' most identifiable song, led by David Ruffin's sultry, dynamic voice. They would go on to be one of the defining sounds of the 60s, despite an ever-rotating membership which keeps The Temptations performing to this day. I myself relate to this iconologic presentation, whereby they are facets, like David Ruffin, that might be notable and distinguishable to others, but to me is only one facet, and certainly there are no permanent ones, of the whole that is me, whom I will continue to be after that facet by which I was recognized is gone. My Girl is a snapshot in the early life of The Temptations, not necessarily reflecting the group as it is now. But that doesn't stop folks from buying tickets to see The Temptations live in concert and having a great time with the talented, legendary group as it is now made up. I hope to be so embraced as I go through all of the artistic and human changes ahead of me, and I hope that the snapshots of my early artistry can begin to pave the way toward success, but not limit me for who I once was. This is the opening performance of Voice, an acoustic guitar cover accompanied by Cam McLean, jazz guitar major. Each performance, performed without a track, is to have one solo accompanist perform with me, highlighting each musician's own style and the way that they've come to love the music. Please enjoy My Girl, dedicated to myself at age 4 when I first loved this song, a girl who deserved all the gentleness of this sonic love.
About my girl, I don't need have sunshine on a cloudy day, babe, with my girl. I've even got the month of May with my girl. Talking about my girl.
For a young female aspiring singer-songwriter, Joni Mitchell is the blueprint. Not only are her lyrics devastating and personal, but clever and fun, and sung in those alluringly lofty pitches that are so feminine and soft. I've always been drawn to Mitchell's inherent softness, and her embracing of that when so many women went the opposite way to harden themselves to match their oftentimes more successful male counterparts. There are a number of Joni Mitchell songs that I was introduced to, along with my peers, during summer camp and early childhood education, encouraging a deep appreciation for the earth and our moments upon it. Following the first song I loved deeply, the second performance of this film is from an artist who gave such sweet permission to love myself deeply, especially through the work that I do for others. This song is called Big Yellow Taxi, conflating a romantic relationship with our treatment of the earth and refraining, "You don't know what you got till it's gone." The taxi takes away both her love and the paradise of the natural world she and many others in the late 20th century became such outspoken activists to save. This song is dedicated to the folks in my life who have put themselves on the line to protect something besides themselves because their principles demanded it, and who have inspired me to become an activist through my words and actions, and hopefully my music.
They paved paradise and put up a parking lot with a pink hotel, a boutique, and a swing in a hot spot. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? You pave paradise and put up a parking lot. It took all the trees and put them in a tree museum, and they charged the people a dollar and a half just to see them. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They paved paradise and put up a parking lot. Hey, farmer, put away that DDT now. Leave me spots on my apples, but leave me the birds and the bees. Please, don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They paved paradise and put up a parking lot. Late last night, I thought I heard that screen door slam, and a big yellow taxi took away my old man. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They paved paradise and put up a parking lot. I said, don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They paved paradise and put up a parking lot. They paved paradise and put up a parking lot. They paved paradise and put up a parking lot.
This film, Voice, is created as part of my college education, wherein I am majoring in rock and roll history. No such degree would be complete without a solid understanding of the Beatles and their influence on Western music. Let It Be, from their eponymous and final album, is one of their most notable songs for its sweet, comforting nature. Though Paul McCartney has insisted it is not a religious song, it's impossible not to hear the gospel influence within it, which was taken and inverted by making the song a true gospel piece for the soundtrack of the movie Across the Universe, a 2007 musical film which reimagines Beatles songs in the context of a sprawling 1969 plot. This movie was very important to me as a kid, not least because of the ever-tear-inducing gospel Let It Be, played over deadly riots and a child's and a soldier's funeral. The massive emotional impact of this song and this presentation of it struck so strongly with me, I had to include it as an impactful song in my history, in addition to the impact it's clearly made on so many. In elementary school, my classmates and I listened to Beatles albums 40 years after their release during art class, singing aloud and often creating beautiful, unrehearsed harmonies. One such classmate, Aria Cohen, agreed to sing with me again on our rendition of Let It Be. I grew to find music a soothing, needed salve for a sometimes abrasive home life, and an increasingly obviously abrasive world to women and Jews. Mental health conditions began to make themselves potent, if not obvious, to the people around me. This solo struggle with a great bottomless sadness and unreality has been relentlessly long, a lifetime. Johnny Cash, whose Live at San Quentin and Live at Folsom Prison albums colored car rides with both my mother and my father following their divorce, famously embodies this oppressive depression, delineated by his famous struggle with drug addiction. His booming baritone echoes in the expanse of a man who has seen and done it all, his conversational tone inviting the listener to a drink, a smoke, and a long talk. My own grappling with emptiness has and will continue to cause me to repel folks I love, the guilt of which only deepening the pit. Johnny Cash expresses all this and more in his soulful rendition of Nine Inch Nails' Hurt, the original artist being a 90s punk industrial rock band, infamous and famous for their explicit lyrics presented clearly and unapologetically. This rendition of Hurt will be performed with just a bass guitar and my old friend, Shay Kangany. You could have it all.
disappear. You are someone else. I am still right here. What have I become? My sweetest friend. Everyone I know goes away in the end. And you could have it all. My empire of dirt. But I will let you down. I will make you hurt. If I could start again, a million miles away, I'd keep myself away. I would find the way.
As my voice developed and the folks around me started to think of me as a singer, my opportunities grew. This phase of my musical discovery plays in the chromatic, sensitive scale of jazz. After hearing At Last by Etta James in the movie Pleasantville, I was so stricken by the smooth sureness of the voice and the swelling cinema of the orchestra, I knew I had to sing this song. I would go on to perform it most notably during my eldest aunt's wedding ceremony, but also to audition my way into Hushir, my collegiate Jewish a cappella group with whom I secured a national championship. And it would be my first solo performance at my musically competitive high school, met with such insistent approval from peers and mentors that I felt, at last, I knew where I belonged. James herself, born Jamesetta Hawkins, had experienced abusive teaching techniques and treatment at the hands of her musical directors and foster parents, which would affect her throughout her career. This truth, paired with her recognition as the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame puts it, the matriarch of the blues, leads her to be an inspiration to me as I empower myself to own my history and forgive myself the few places I must go slower than my differently impacted peers, and to know that I will still be loved, honored, and impactful. At Last is performed solo with a track dedicated to folks who are fortifying themselves in forgiveness in the hopes that they too can find a place at last to rest.
Oh, you are mine.
Another woman who did not consider herself primarily a jazz woman, but who certainly left her mark on the genre, was Nina Simone. Initially hoping to be a concert pianist and composer, but denied from elite academies due to racism, Simone made do and became a nightclub player, the humble beginnings of a fruitful career synthesizing multiple musical genres, including gospel, pop, and classical. Her often-covered Feelin' Good is the feel-good song, never fading long enough even to necessitate resurfacing, though many people are unaware of the song's civil rights roots as a celebration of freedom. Simone, like Joni Mitchell, utilized her platform as a music icon to sing and speak about issues plaguing her community. Simone also famously coped with bipolar disorder, often negatively affecting both personal and business relationships. This song is dedicated to the people who advocate for their own ethical treatment. That work is the work which makes the world treat itself right. If we keep pushing and relentlessly inspire and embolden the way music does, we will together know how good true freedom feels. Enjoy Feelin' Good.
Birds flying high, you know how I feel. Sun in the sky, you know how I feel. Breeze drifting on by, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me, yeah. It's a new dawn, it's a new day. It's a new life for me. Ooh. And I'm feeling good. Fish in the sea, you know how I feel. River running free, you know how I feel. Blossom on the tree, you know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me. And I'm feeling good. Dragonfly out in the sunny, you know what I mean, don't you know? Butterflies are all having fun, you know what I mean? Sleep in peace when day is done, that's what I mean. And this old world is a new world and a bold world for me. Yeah, yeah. Stars, when you shine, you know how I feel. Scent of the pine, you know how I feel. Oh, freedom is mine, and I know how I feel. It's a new dawn, it's a new day, it's a new life for me.
The Chicks, formerly known as the Dixie Chicks, are famous not only for their powerhouse country and bluegrass stylings, but for their public political development. In 2003, the group was blacklisted across the country music scene and even received numerous death threats for telling an audience that they did not support Bush's war in Iraq, leading to years of inactivity. They issued an apology, which they later retracted. They would go on to change their name away from referencing the Confederacy, which the rest of the country music scene largely continues to embrace. This honest assessment of values in the face of community backlash lands the Chicks near to my heart as sturdy musical role models. I hope I am as honest and secure in my philosophy as they demonstrated themselves to be. My mother, a dedicated feminist, always reminded me of their intelligence, their choices, and their power. And for that, I will always be reminded of her when I hear the strength in the voice of Natalie Maines, the Chicks' mighty lead singer. Not Ready to Make Nice is a message directly to the fans who shunned them so violently for speaking out against the war in Iraq. And for me is a song dripping with self-assuredness, fully embraced pain and anger, and the power of women who have decided that they aren't actually sorry for being themselves. The song is dedicated to my mom, who showed me that it's not only my right, but my duty to speak my mind and my heart unapologetically. Dissenters be damned.
Shit, I did it again.
Forty years earlier, another feminist anthem, You Don't Own Me, was released in 1964. Leslie Gore was 17 when she debuted the song, which emphasized the autonomy demanded by the second wave of feminism in direct contrast to social standards of gender relations. The song seems to decry a possessive lover, but I cannot hear it without thinking of the ownership my father took over me and the great strain I was under to even learn who I was in the face of who I was allowed to be. I hear Leslie complain that her boyfriend won't let her spend time with men at all, and I'm reminded of my dad threatening me and any boy who liked me, like many of our parents normalized. The pseudo-sexual ownership of fathers over their daughters and any expression of their sexuality is a deep-reaching facet of a harmful patriarchal society which has and will continue to impact me, making aspects of performing and functioning unnecessarily strenuous and often emotional. You Don't Own Me is dedicated to young girls whom I promise to always protect from forces who would have them shrink to become a better accessory for a man. This song is dedicated to teenage girls who receive far too much lust, who deserve so much more love than they get.
You don't own me. I'm not just one of your many toys. You don't own me. Don't say I can't go with other boys. And don't tell me what to do. And don't tell me what to say. And please, when I go out with you, don't put me on display. 'Cause you don't own me. Don't try to change me in any way. You don't own me. Don't tie me down, 'cause I never stay. I don't tell you what to say. I don't tell you what to do. So please let me be myself. That's all I ask of you. I'm young, and I love to be young. I'm free, and I love to be free.
Continuing in the theme of self-expression and independence, we'll now jump to the 80s. Freddie Mercury, as the frontman of Queen, elevated energetic performance and presence to new heights. Bisexual, like myself, Mercury was an LGBT icon at the height of the AIDS epidemic, which would ultimately take his life. "I Want to Break Free" may have been written by bassist John Deacon, but the controversial In America music video, in which all of the band members dress in drag, with Freddie so expertly brushing his bob back from his mustache, breathes new meaning into this breakup song. I did not recognize my own sexuality until I was 19, but the years and months leading up to that conclusion were rife with this tension of wishing to burst past the heteronormative barriers, restricting me to an unfamiliar person, unclear in which direction to explode that energy. Mercury carries a torch of gay energy that lit the oppressive, lethal darkness of homophobia, which had always shrouded puritanical America and caused it to turn on itself and its own. Even the brash, belty timbre of his voice demands recognition, acceptance, and the communal empowerment of each person singing along to his irresistible melodies, taking up the full range of his own body. Singing "I Want to Break Free" makes me feel freer. This song is dedicated to Luke Smith, who passed away last year after a lifetime of unabashed, flamboyant self-expression, which he modeled for and encouraged in me. May his memory live on in the free embellishment of the identities of the people who loved him.
I want to break free. I want to break free. I want to break free from your lies. You're so self-satisfied. I don't need you. I've got to break free. God knows I want to break free. I've fallen in love. I've fallen in love for the first time, and this time I know it's for real. I've fallen in love. God knows I've fallen in love. It's strange, but it's true. I can't get over the way you love me like you do. But I have to be sure when I walk out that door. Whoa, how I want to be free, baby. Whoa, how I want to be free. Oh, how I want to break. But life still goes on. I can get used to living without you by my side. I don't wanna live alone. God knows I gotta make it on my own. So baby, can't you see? To break free, I've got to break free. I want to break free. Yeah.
To be fearlessly, truthfully oneself is the point of music to me. It's nearly impossible to truly embody oneself without the inhibitions the world demands one place on themselves. But the magic of music is such that it draws the truth, even unwilling, from the depths of self-delusion. This philosophy of emotional vulnerability in music comes from the African aesthetic, woven into contemporary Western music from its root genres of blues, and before that, gospel. Carole King wrote Natural Woman for Aretha Franklin, the Queen of Soul, to sing, and while Franklin's version is the more energized and certainly culturally dominant version, King's own rendition of the song carries a sweet, incredibly soft sadness for all the time wasted before finding love and becoming her full self, which feels accurate to the grief I hope to portray. It also lends itself better to acoustic solo playing. Even the term natural woman carries significance to me, as a woman who has never shaved her legs or had a piercing, and who is literally constantly forced to explain my reasoning for mainly the first disparity, or else be subjected to repulsion and expulsion. It seemed for years as though I would have to choose between my natural body and my femininity. The smile in King's voice rings with the relief of the wholeness of being fully loved as you are, which in turn completes you. I'd like to dedicate Natural Woman to folks whose ideal care for their body deviates from how others want to perceive it, and the folks who will love them wholly for it. Please enjoy Natural Woman, accompanied by Alinase Mzumara. The infinitely complex nature of relationships has guided so much of my life and my mind. empathetically encapsulated in the wide discography of Fleetwood Mac. While Rumours is famous for exploring the intricacies of the band's interpersonal conflicts and relations, and all of their big, beautiful feelings about them, one notable song left off of the album leaves a significant hole in the story. Stevie Nicks' Silver Springs, about her and Lindsey Buckingham's breakup, which was released as a B-side to the Go Your Own Way single telling Buckingham's side, which was included on Rumours, was underpromoted and underrated after exclusion from the album. Who among us cannot relate to having our side of the story quelled and quieted? The song also draws me back to my mother, who introduced me to this song and Nicks, and who was so strong-armed by a wealthier team of lawyers in her divorce and custody cases, and who fought with every minute and dollar to make my brother and me safe and happy, who showed me how to never stop speaking reality and not allowing it to be rewritten by a louder, more authoritative speaker. Silver Springs is about a breakup, but the history of the song makes it about standing your ground in your truth of your experiences, despite what folks want to hear. And its later success reminds us of the justice brought when the quieted voice is not ever silenced. Enjoy Silver Springs, performed with Aria Cohen on the piano. As we come to the close of Voice, I would like to pivot from songs that gave me answers to a song that invites me to ask questions. What's Up, by Four Non Blondes, led by Linda Perry, asks the existential questions that plague and heal youth, allowing them to build themselves in their own image. She sets the song establishing herself as a 20-something without direction and refrains, "What's going on?" in a desperate plea to understand her life, fluctuating between full-bodied raspy lows and intense towering highs within a single line in a frenzied foolhardy sprint. I can't think of a better way to bring my story up to the present. As I stand on the brink of my career, not knowing what path it will take or even that I want it to take, unsure of everything except that wherever I go, there will be music there. I am grateful for the people in my life who encourage me today. In my first and current rock band, Sloan Ranger, I play with three rockers who'd been playing together for decades before bringing me in. They've taught me so much about being a band as my first non-institutional music group and have been one of the most positive musical experiences of my life. To conclude this musical narrative, please enjoy What's Up, performed with Jeremy Alley, Sloan Ranger's guitarist, one of the first of many fulfilling professional musical friendships.
Big hill I'm holding for the distance.
Bye.